Are you troubled by Rob Porter's employment in the White House?
Yes, on two levels. One's the interim security clearance issue, but even more importantly, I spent two decades believing women and children who alleged abuse, even sometimes when no one else did. So whether or not there's a security clearance at issue or not, I have real questions about how someone like this could be considered for employment, whether there's a security clearance or not. So, yeah, I'm troubled by almost every aspect of this.
And so now that we know that, I mean, according to yesterday, Chris Wray's testimony, that they told the White House four times, they gave the White House four different installments of the report, some of them complete, that included the allegations from the ex-wives of violence. So how could he still have a job at the White House?
That's a great question and one that I can't answer. I didn't hire him. But who knew what, when, and to what extent? Those are the questions that I think ought to be asked. And Congress has a role to play, but quite frankly, so does the public and so does the media. Who knew what, when, and to what extent? And if you knew it in 2017 and the Bureau briefed him three times, then how in the hell was he still employed? The security clearance is a separate issue. I mean, it's an important issue, but it's separate. How do you have any job if you have credible allegations of domestic abuse? I am biased towards the victim. I spent two decades believing them. But you don't have to be biased towards the victim to ask, how in the hell did this happen?
Well, our reporting, CNN's reporting, is that Don McGahn, White House Chief Counsel, and John Kelly, Chief of Staff, did know. So what does it say about them?
No offense to your reporting, but I would want to know from Don McGahn and General Kelly and anyone else, what did you know, from whom did you hear it, to what extent did you hear it, and then what actions, if any, did you take? The chronology is not favorable for the White House. When you have the head of the FBI saying, we told you three times in 2017 and once more in 2018 for good measure, then I think the really fair questions are, what were you told, by whom were you told it, did you have some reason to question what the Bureau told you, and if none of that is true, why did you keep him on? So Don's one person to ask, General Kelly's one person to ask. There may be others at the White House, but those are the questions going through my mind. What did you know? When did you know it? To what extent were you told? And did you have any reason in the world to doubt the information that was provided to you? Because I can't think of what that reason would be.
Well, listen, those are great questions. You're the chairman of the Oversight Committee. Are you going to investigate?
We do have jurisdiction over the security clearance process. I do not have jurisdiction over who the president hires. That's a branch integrity
issue.
Sure,
but in terms of, listen, you could get into this. You could investigate what Rob Porter was doing there, and certainly without full security clearance. So are you launching, is your committee going to launch an investigation?
The very first thing I did when I landed yesterday was sit down with my senior staff at Oversight and find out what we're going to do. But Allison,
And what's the answer?
Congress has lots of questions of the executive branch that go unanswered. So
yeah.
I said about 3 minutes ago, there are three different people who have a role here. Congress definitely has a role. Mm-hmm. So do you,
sure.
And so does the public.
Agreed.
And I would imagine the public is really interested as well. And sometimes it's harder to ignore the public than it is to ignore
Congress.
I hear
you. And listen, we've been asking questions for 8 days. We've been talking about it for 8 days. But what's your plan on the committee?
To ask the FBI for a briefing, number one, because I want to hear from Chris Wray. What did you learn? When did you learn it? And to whom did you communicate it?
But
then from that would develop a list of witnesses where you could go from there.
Yeah,
but the first thing I want to know is...
And I'm sorry to interrupt, but we do have those answers. We do have those answers from Chris Wray. He testified to them yesterday, March 2017, almost a year ago, he submitted a report to the White House, July
Allison,
2017.
I got the dates. I got the dates. Do you know what he told them?
So
that's my question.
Okay.
The dates are really important. What I want to know from Chris Wray is, what with specificity did you learn? When did you learn it? And with whom did you share it? And when did you share it? I got the dates. Mm-hmm. I heard that. But my follow-up question is, okay, Chris, how thorough was the investigation? What did you share? With whom did you share it? And what were the updates? If you updated the information four times, what was the second, third, and fourth iteration of that update? I'm with you on the chronology.
Yeah.
I'm with you there. I've got that. But I have additional questions for the FBI. And then once you get the answers to that, you know who to direct your inquiries at the White House.
He was reluctant to answer those yesterday. He was asked that. He was reluctant to answer those because I think that he said that he doesn't comment on sort of ongoing personnel issues or an investigation. So hopefully you can get...
Welcome to our world. I told you a couple of minutes ago, Congress can ask, but if the executive branch doesn't answer the questions, then that's when you need the public and the media to also increase the pressure. So
yes.
I get that he doesn't want to talk about an ongoing investigation. This does not appear to be ongoing to me anymore.
But just so that I'm clear, will the Oversight Committee be launching an investigation into this?
We did last night.
So it's official?
That word probably means more to you than it does to me. What matters to me is that we are directing inquiries to people that we think have access to information we don't have. You can call it official. You can call it unofficial. Those words don't mean anything to me. What means something to me is I'm going to direct questions to the FBI that I expect them to answer. And if they don't answer them, then they're going to need to give me a really good reason. And you'll learn that reason, and you can judge whether or not it's a sufficient reason or not. But unless you're Jack Bauer, you can't make people answer questions. I've been trying for 7 years to get certain people to answer questions without a whole lot of success. We're going to try, and then we could use your help if they say no.
Well, for sure, you can count on us for that. But the reason that
I'm pressing
in terms of whether it's official is because, as you know, the ranking Democrat on your committee, Elijah Cummings, has been, he says, pressing you to look into this, Rob Porter's employment, and the reason that he was handling classified documents without full security clearance. He says he's been pressing you for months to do this and that you've been resisting looking into this. Is that true?
No, ma'am.
Here is what the letter he sent to you says. This is from Elijah Cummings. It appears that the Oversight Committee has constructed a wall around the White House in order to prevent any credible oversight whatsoever. Rob Porter served as White House Staff Secretary, a critical gatekeeper in terms of vetting and managing all documents reaching the president's desk. If our committee does not investigate these allegations, it is unclear who will. So why did he feel the need to tell you that this has to be investigated? He says that you were reluctant.
Well, you'll have to ask Elijah that question. Our committee has investigated travel. We have investigated the use of private email. I'm smiling because I'm remembering how few inquiries Elijah launched under the last administration.
I understand.
We're going to look into it. But Elijah writes lots of letters, and this is one, just like the gymnastics scandal. I wasn't prompted last night by what Elijah asked me to do. I was prompted by the facts.
Yes, and I hear you, and I'm just trying to stay in the present. So forget what happened in the past, because we could be here all day. But in the present, are you troubled that Rob Porter had access to classified documents and information without full security clearance? As we've learned, so do something between 30 and 40 White House staffers, including top aide Jared Kushner.
Yes. I'm also troubled by the fact that someone with these allegations in his background could get any job at the White House from Gardner on down. So whether or not there's a security clearance at issue, that's a really important point. What's also important to me is, even if there were no classified information, how did someone with this allegation in his background get a job at the White House? Those are two really important issues. But Allison, I'll tell you, you don't want people with domestic violence allegations hired, whether there's a security clearance at issue or not.
Is the security clearance process broken, as Dan Coats?
Yes.
And what's broken about it?
Well, anytime you have a backlog, you got two issues. Are there too many applicants, or are there too few resources to process the applicants? We're all kind of creatures of our own experience. I had a two-star general that had to go through the security clearance background when he left the Army and joined a committee of Congress. I'm not sure how somebody with 30 years of government experience needs 8 months more of investigation. One of the best people I've ever met in my life, she's never broken curfew. It took her a year to get a security clearance. That's too long when you're hiring people for really fact-centric jobs. A year is too long to wait. So maybe you got too many applicants. You certainly have too few resources. Anytime you got a backlog, you got to look at those two factors.
Okay. You have announced that you're retiring. Why are you getting out of this racket?
because I miss my old job. I miss the justice system. I like jobs where facts matter. I like jobs where fairness matters. I like jobs, frankly, where the process matters. And it's not just about winning, and it's not just about reaching a result. There's a proper way to do things. There are confessions thrown out because police didn't follow the right protocol. There are search warrants thrown out. So I am more at peace in jobs that reward fairness and that are fact-centric than I am in Congress.
And so facts don't matter in Congress?
I think what matters in Congress is finding a group and then validating or ratifying what they already believe. The art of persuasion, in 7 years, I haven't seen anyone's mind change by a speech, by a debate. It's about ratification and validation. I like the art of persuasion. I like finding 12 people who have not already made up their minds and then made the facts prevail. That's not where we are in politics. So maybe we'll get back there. Maybe my great-granddaughter will have a different experience. But right now, I like the art of persuasion. I like it when facts matter, and I don't see that in our current modern political environment. Mm.
That is quite a testament to where we are today. Congressman Trey Gowdy, we really appreciate you coming on with all of
your
perspective. Thanks so much.
Yes, ma'am. Chris. Thank you.